It's that time again, another episode. I am the Colonialist, and these are my Polyacus Dives, aka the Lesser Weaver Ants. They probably don't even need an introduction because I have featured them that many times on my channel. In fact, I think they are the highest featured colony, but I love interacting with them. There's always so much going on, and the colony lately has been an absolute ball of activity. The action within the nest has been non-stop, and I've been really lucky to be able to film so much of what's been going on. As it turns out, just like you guys, I'm not the only one that's excited about all the incoming news to do with this colony. I mean, just check out this worker, she's shouting about it. And is that the queen? Is she carrying a worker? Hey, just off to the far right. That could possibly be, I'm not too sure, I didn't spot the wing scars. Let me know if you spot them. But yeah, look, this worker, she's just so excited about everything that's been happening. If you just watch her, she's just telling everyone. She's like, hey, look, get together. You gotta watch this because it's been an absolutely incredible journey, and I really have been quite lucky to film it. And you know, we'll go into what's been going on. So there has been not just one nest constructed, there's been two nests and a nuptial flight. So should we get into where it first started, at least where it first started specifically for this episode, not when I originally got the colony? And it first started a little bit like this. A few days beforehand, I dropped in some more substrate and I noticed that they started to use it to weave a nest. I was just walking past and there they are. And it was just amazing to watch them weave it all together and then use the larvae to stick it in and start to build a foundation. It's interesting how you see the workers working from both sides to push the wall to put it correctly in place. And then you have another worker going around with a larvae, lightly sticking those bits in place just to hold the foundations so that they can build upon them, making them as strong as possible, not just weaving the materials together but also sticking those weaves together so they almost stitch the weaves that they've weaved to add extra strength to the chamber that they're building, which is actually quite incredible if you think about the thought process that goes on behind that and how they've developed the ability to learn this or create these structures using the natural resources formed within their own colony and social structures. It always begs the question, certainly in my mind, how do they develop this knowledge knowing that this is a captive colony that I've had since a queen? Are they born with this information? Do they pass it on genetically, which is also quite an interesting science to dive into and way beyond my own personal knowledge at this current time? Stemming from that small chamber, this is what they've created simply a few days later. All of them still tirelessly working together as a team to create a megastructure. You can't consider it to be anything else, because if they weren't defined by the size limit of these pods, I'm sure that these nests would be massive. The fact that they've not just built one, but they've built two, and then the amount of brood that they filled the nest with, I imagine that if they had the space to build freely, this structure would be supersized. But at least this way, we get to see the chambers, which means we get this amazing treat right here. Look at the amount of pupae, and this is just prior to the nuptial flight, so much of this pupae may have even been the female elates or the male drones, as well as workers. But it's so amazing to see such an incredible amount of pupae and see how they're all divided out and stacked within the chambers, as well as having that opportunity to see how they build the structures, maintain their nest, and move around their nest using the space that they've designed and built themselves. They started the construction of their second nest while I was away, but this is what I came home to. They had already got quite far into construction, and in this nest they had built the chamber walls all the way up to the roof of the pod, which meant I can no longer open the pod lid without disturbing their nest, as they've weaved part of it to the lid and that would break it when I open it. It's not too bad though, because I don't really need to access their nesting pods. Unless there's an emergency, I just leave them to it. And luckily, because of how the vents are, I can actually hydrate the nest through the vents and just let the water drip through naturally. At least that helps me to maintain their humidity, which then isn't an issue for me. I still can't help but find myself in utter awe when I watch this colony. It's incredible how they build these structures and how industrious they are. It always does stay in the forefront of my mind, exactly how they get this knowledge. If it's passed on by the Queen, how does she do so? Is it genetically passed on? Is it just a knowledge they are born with? Is it something that they experience, or do they find out through trial and error? It seems such a short period of time that they're able to construct such amazing structures and nests. So I would love to find out more about that, and be sure I will be doing my research to see if I can understand exactly how they pass on or learn this information. One thing that I've learned through keeping this species is they have a very complex nature, both in social structure and colony design. If you're new to my series that follows this colony, then you should know that a while ago I had two colonies of this species, and sadly one queen passed away, and I decided to try and merge the colonies, which actually seemed to kick off this industrious period that the colony's been going through. I can't say it's related, but the colonies showed an incredible amount of brood since, and they've also kicked off a nuptial flight. I'm not going to pretend that the footage that I've captured of this is of the best quality or it's amazing footage, but it's still amazing to see some of the behavior that goes on and how it's so easy to miss a nuptial flight from this species, because so much of the mating actually happens inside the nest. The queens are able to clone themselves, and the males are given the diverse genetics that the original queen is mated with. This means that the colony or the species itself can self-procreate, meaning they don't need an outside source or another colony to be able to mate with, to be able to continue a new line or succession of queens. If you keep this species, one thing I'd love to hear from you guys is, what's your most intriguing experience watching your polyacus dives? That would be amazing. So let me know down in the comments. And if you don't keep them, have you ever thought about keeping them? They're amazing. But honestly, don't do so unless you can take on that responsibility. It is serious when it comes to that aspect. And so not just for Christmas, they're for life, just like a dog. This nuptial flight alone has been sporadic within the colony and has been happening for around a month. Sudden bursts of activity and the late mating within the nest. But sadly, I've also seen much carnage, which I did not expect to see. I was always told that this species accepted its new queens back into the nest. Now, it is of course a possibility that some of these queens have been accepted, but from what I've witnessed so far, many have been executed. Both male drones, which I did expect, and female alates. Not all of them, but many of them have been picked off. This queen seems safe for now. Perhaps she's unmated, I don't know. Or perhaps the workers are just keeping a close eye on her until the deed is done. It would be interesting to find out, but this is as much as I've captured on the flight so far. Judging by the amount of brood, going back to this clip I showed you earlier and the expansion on the nest, there is so much more in store to come with this colony. As well as, I recently ordered a much taller pod for them, which is going to help them nest arboreally, and it seems like it's just come just in time, because it's now going to give them even more options to create something incredible for you all to enjoy. I'm really, really enjoying being able to share this all with you, and I personally can't wait for the next installment. I can't wait to film more. And unfortunately, I did actually have a lot more footage than this, and again, me and technology, we're not the best of friends. I am trying, I am learning, I am doing my best, and I'll continue to try, but yeah, I lost a load more files, so I think it's to do with the memory cards that I bought. So I've bought different memory cards, and I'll try to use those, because I'm using 128 gig memory cards, and I've got some 32 and 64 gigabytes now, so I'll give them a try and see how they work within the phone. That brings us to the end of the update for the polyacus dives. I hope you've enjoyed the incredible journey seeing them weave the nests. I wish I did have more footage. It seems like you've captured so much more when you capture it all in hyperlapses, but then it's all condensed down hours and hours of footage. So in other news, which I'll start with, I finally edited episode 3 of the Colonial Antcast. Yes, I know it's been a long time coming, and I wish I had got it all in the bag sooner, But that's done and that's under review with my other co-hosts. So that's Ants Hood, My Living World Ants, and Ant Holofer. Once they approve it, it's going to go up. So hopefully that'll be later on today. I know it's early morning right now in the UK, but this is my time to edit and send. So I'm going to get this episode out as soon as I'm done recording. On top of that amazing news, Formicast, the absolute legend, has asked me to be a co-host on his podcast, and he's recently started streaming live to YouTube, and it's been so much fun being part of his projects. So I really could not turn down the opportunity to work with the guy, and he's helping us over at the Colonial Antcast to get our content out and improve it so you guys can enjoy it all the more. So now you're going to find us popping up across this little community that we're starting to build. The content is just getting absolutely crazy. You're not just following myself, but you're starting to follow a team of ant keepers, which to me personally is really exciting because we've all got so many different views and opinions, and we've all done so many different things, and it's just genuinely something that's great to be a part of. So I'll see you all there, and I'll get to the end of the episode. This is The Colonialist. Thank you so much for joining me, and I'll catch you guys next time. I'm signing out.